Good evening. I'm Jack Rosenthal, the interim director of Roosevelt House. As you may know, this was the New York home of Franklin and Eleanor Roosevelt for some 25 years before they came into possession of a somewhat larger house at 1600 Pennsylvania Avenue. It's now the home to occasions for assessment of timely public policy issues, like government secrecy, the subject of Fritz Schwarz's new book, Democracy in the Dark. Fritz is the scion of the famous Toy family. He grew up demonstrating excellence. Harvard Magna, Harvard Law Review editor, Court of Appeals clerk, and then, ignoring most career guidance, he went to Nigeria to help create the laws of a new nation. After he returned to Cravath, Swain, and Moore, the quality of his work on the IBM antitrust case led to his being chosen as the chief counsel for Senator Frank Church's famous Committee on Intelligence. That investigation in 1975 and 1976 threw back the covers on domestic spying by the FBI and CIA and government-sanctioned attempts to assassinate foreign leaders. After Fritz came back to a second tour at Cravath, he was quickly engrossed in some famous other cases. In 1977, he persuaded Judge Constance Baker Motley that to allow women sports writers to interview players in the locker room would not corrupt public morals. In 1982, he again took leave for public service, this time for 5 years as New York City's chief lawyer. And then in 1989, he agreed to chair the commission that changed the way New York City is governed. Its work touched the most sensitive toes, and yet he insisted that all its meetings be open, a decision that in fact ended up building crucial public support. Fritz doesn't just preach openness, he practices it. As this book demonstrates yet again, Fritz Schwarz truly believes in democracy and urges us all to do the same. Joining us tonight are Sarah Bartlett, the Dean of the CUNY Graduate School of Journalism, whose career includes service at Fortune, Business Week, and the New York Times, and Gabriel Schoenfeld, Senior Fellow at the Hudson Institute, and author of Necessary Secrets, The National Security, the Media, and the Rule of Law, a 2010 book from a somewhat different perspective than Fritz. First, Fritz, could we ask you if you'd come tell us a little bit about your book?
Thank you, Mr. Jack. So thanks a lot, Jack. I'll try to make these comments shorter than I usually do and finish with talking a little bit about journalism in the American system and why it's so important. So there are three major findings about secrecy that I think are fair. One, we have too much and it lasts too long. Second, some secrecy is necessary. And third, too often secrecy is used to hide illegality and embarrassment. But passing from those three points, let me make two points that are contrary to conventional wisdom. The first is that excess secrecy is not only due to illegality and embarrassment plus legitimate secrets. Excess secrecy happens because of many more banal reasons, ambition, human character reasons that lead to excess secrecy and have nothing to do with illegality or embarrassment. Indeed, with the number of documents that are becoming top secret and secret now, it's about 100 million each year. The one thing that's happening is secrecy spawns more secrecy.
as people who want to get noticed feel they have to label their document as top secret or else it won't get noticed at all. Another point that's contrary to conventional wisdom is that classification is not the only problem. There are other aspects of secrecy which have nothing to do with classification. One would be, just one quick example, the presidential documents, which for 180 years were regarded as belonging to the individual presidents, and they then could destroy them, or like the Adams family who made them available, not make them available for 150 years. But that's a form of denying the public information, but it's got nothing to do with classification. I developed the argument in the book that 9/11 could have been prevented if the many secret warnings that the CIA gave to the White House had been publicly distributed. It would have empowered the FBI agents who were worried about people of investigative interest learning to fly, but whose arguments to do something got nowhere. And it would have empowered the public to think, and I think the public would have said, well, if there's really going to be something as serious as that language says, why not a flying bomb in an airplane? So the one of the ultimate causes of too much secrecy is an attitude that you can't rely on the public to deal with difficult issues. And if you can't rely on the public to deal with difficult issues, it enhances your willingness, your ability to be secret, to keep things secret. Leslie Gelb, who pulled together the Pentagon Papers, was Assistant Secretary of State, was a New York Times reporter, and then was head of the Council on Foreign Relations, said there is a patronizing attitude toward the public. So at the end of the day, what is important is the connection, in my mind, between excess secrecy and democracy. Because what are the hymns of our nation? One is the Declaration of Independence, where Jefferson says, a just government is based on the consent of the governed. Another is Lincoln's Gettysburg Address, where he says, we hereby vow not to let government of the people, by the people, and for the people perish from this earth. Well, to get Jefferson's consent, you can't have it unless the public is reasonably informed. To get Lincoln's government by the public, you can't get it unless the public is reasonably informed. So now just turning to a couple of points about journalism that are in the book. One is that the papers, newspapers, have been absolutely vital to American democracy. Madison, right at the start of the country, said, in a democracy, an informed citizenry is the master, should be the master. And you can't do that unless there are newspapers. And Tocqueville and others recognized that newspapers were absolutely necessary to American democracy. By the 1830s, and when Madison made that comment that I quoted, he then pushed for subsidies for newspapers that were in the first Post Office Department Act. The consequence by the 1830s was that 90% of the mail by weight were newspapers, but only about 12% of the revenue of the Postal Department was from newspapers because of government subsidies. I think, however, there is an important difference between the role of American journalism in the era of Tocqueville and running all the way up through the early part of the 20th century, where their main role of newspapers was to diffuse information, get the information around. Now, today, there are plenty of other technological devices that get information around, and newspapers are not any longer vital to the diffusion of information. But they are, I believe, vital to the discovery of information. And one issue to consider is how long can newspapers continue to do that? I have a little fact in the book that I got from the editor of Der Spiegel at a conference. The conference was called From the Pentagon Papers to WikiLeaks. It was before Snowden. And in what he said is that when the Chelsea Manning papers, diplomatic papers, were released through WikiLeaks and sometimes a little carelessly released, but when he put a team of almost 50 people to work for 4 months checking those out, you know, that's really expensive, and can newspapers continue to do that? And then one final fact that I've deduced from thinking about journalism today is the government was extremely lucky that it lost the Pentagon Papers case, which Max Frankel had a lot to do with the government losing through his great affidavit that is one of the great descriptions of how much the government itself leaks information and so forth. But the government was lucky that it lost the Pentagon Papers case because newspapers now don't face the threat of a restraint, a prior restraint on what they publish. And therefore, they are more willing to do what we also did on the Church Committee, which is to let the government know what you intend to publish so it can suggest to you, argue to you, try to convince you that something that you're planning to publish actually is going to reveal the identity of a source in Egypt or something like that. And I think that practice of consultation among journalists and the government is good. The danger is if it is allowed to go on for too long. And there I thought the New York Times in their article of 2005, which Gabe and I have some differences about, but their article saying Bush administration returns to warrantless wiretapping, they did have those discussions, but I think taking a full year before they published it was too much. So that's a little bit about the book and a little bit about some things on journalism, and I hope we have a great dialogue.
Let me take the opportunity to ask the first question, and it's the obvious question. Who should decide what secrets should be secret? Gabriel, would you like to start?
Yes. Who should decide? I think it is the most fundamental question at issue between us. I should say before I enter into that, that this is a really excellent book, very thoughtful, and I urge everyone to buy it and read it. There's a very striking difference in our system between what the laws say and what the practice is. Under the Espionage Act of 1917, it's not quite clear if it's a crime to publish secret information, but two leading liberal scholars who wrote a magisterial law review article reviewing the Espionage Act described it as a pointed gun, loaded, pointing at journalism. Because it could be deployed to prosecute a journalist who published a government secret. Now, in our history, there's never been such a prosecution, or at least never been a successful prosecution. But we came close during World War II when the Chicago Tribune published information suggesting that the United States had broken the Japanese codes. And if the Japanese had actually paid attention to that article, the cost to the United States would have been tremendous. The war would have been prolonged. Thousands of people would have lost their lives. And I think it's a critical case because it shows that in the final analysis, it is the government that should retain the right to prosecute journalists, even if that right is never exercised, that journalists operate as kind of, well, they're massively violating the law. It's like, I would liken it to jaywalking in New York City. We massively violate the law. It's never it's very seldom prosecuted, but it should be prosecuted when someone is wandering onto the West Side Highway, but not when you're crossing 56th Street. And when somebody publishes the fundamental codes or a recipe for making aerosolized anthrax, I think that journalist does deserve to be published, prosecuted. And I think the public, we live in a regime where the public would want that and deserves it.
Sarah, you're eager to pick up.
Well, I just it seems to me that you didn't really directly answer the question, you know, which is who has the right to decide what should be published and what shouldn't. You were really focusing on should journalists be prosecuted for...
Well, because ultimately I would say that the prosecutors and ultimately juries would make the final decision about whether something was criminal. But fortunately in our history, that's never happened.
But you're suggesting that journalists, I think there's a sort of a little bit of an inference that journalists are playing fast and loose with the law. And at least in my experience, the journalists that I've always worked with when there are situations like this are, as you mentioned earlier, Fritz, they're talking with the government, there's consultation, they're not willy-nilly releasing state secrets and breaking the law in a sort of wanton way.
I completely agree with that. However, journalism is a changing thing, and also journalism in our system, it's not quite clear who is a journalist. Anyone can be a journalist, including foreigners, including, we have like Red Star Daily from China. They could also obtain secrets and publish them. So in a world where anyone can be a journalist, we can't have a free-for-all about information, although I'm happy that the government has never exercised this power.
You know, there's another branch of government, which one would expect could mediate these kinds of issues, called the courts. I was very much struck by the excellent chapter in Fritz's book in which he tells why the extraordinary lassitude of the unwillingness of the courts, maybe one could even say cowardly behavior in refusing to take their responsibility. Is that something, Fritz, you'd like to talk about?
Sure. Well, fear is important. Fear is always important. It's important for all of the branches. The courts are afraid of making a mistake, and they're also refused to do what the Congress told them to do in the Freedom of Information Act amendments, which is to, generally speaking, review the documents that the government claims should be denied in a FOIA case, and to put the burden on the government. The court can be criticized for a lot of reasons. One, to get to my main theme about democracy, it simply does not ever recognize that the right of the people to participate is a key element of democracy. It pays a lot of attention to checks and balances as a sort of unphrased part of our Constitution, but it doesn't pay any attention to the importance to democracy of information getting to the public. The courts also don't learn from their own experience. The government has constantly misrepresented the facts to courts. In Korematsu, they misrepresented the facts. In the Pentagon Papers, they tried to prove harm and just grossly failed, totally failed to prove harm. In the Clapper case, the Director of National Security lied to the Congress, and the court, they don't pay any attention to the behavior of the government, and they have never, and I kind of say in this book here, there's never been a Brandeis brief for the court that presents the risks and dangers of secrecy, and I'm kind of hoping this book can do that. And now if I could just say something, Gabe is right about the Chicago Tribune in when it revealed that we'd broken the Japanese code. That was utterly irresponsible. Now the only reason they weren't prosecuted is for the usual problem that the government worries that they'll alert the Japanese, in this case, to what was being done to them. That's really the only reason they were not prosecuted. Biddle, the Attorney General, then was pushing hard for their prosecution. Today, and here's a point about technology which we always have to keep thinking about, Today it would be impossible for the Japanese not to know about the Chicago Tribune article, just like it would have been impossible for both the Germans and the Japanese not to know about the amazing number of leaks there were about our work on the atomic bomb. With today's internet technology and search methods, the Tribune secret would have been known to the Japanese, and the fact we were working on the atomic bomb would clearly have been known to both the Germans and the Japanese.
One of the things that I think is so striking in reading your book is the imbalance that is in this current period between the volume of secrets that are being sort of classified as such and the essentially the shrinking of the journalism industry that might be on guard watching, performing their role as a watchdog. And I think while you rightly say that, you know, the definition of a journalist is blurring now, the number of organizations that have the wherewithal to hire reporters who are experienced and who can afford to spend the time and the resources to dig through and file FOIA requests, which sit on desks for months at a time, and have the legal staff to pursue these on behalf of these institutions. The number of those organizations is shrinking, and the resources that people can put into this kind of work. So I think that the culture of secrecy that you're describing is sort of in perfect imbalance with what's happening in the profession, and I think that's something that we should all be very concerned about.
Sarah, at the same time, while there's been a decrease in the number of mainstream media or their capacity to do investigative reporting, there remain some, and some new ones. On the other hand, there's been a vast increase in the number of what could be called news outlets, whether it ranged from blogs to ProPublica. Does quantity outweigh the loss of quality?
That's a tough question. I think there are some organizations that are new and are web-only publications like ProPublica, which partner with mainstream media organizations to get their stories out, certainly are making an important difference. And I think the rise of nonprofit journalistic outlets is helping. Whether that can possibly counterbalance the loss of expertise, I mean, we see constantly, not just at the New York Times, but at a lot of you know, serious media organizations, layoffs of some of the most experienced professionals. And I think you may get younger people coming in to sort of fill those shoes, but they don't have the level of knowledge and sort of generational experience that I think can be so significant in this kind of work in particular.
Gabe Fritz made an interesting point in his remarks and in the book that there's a distinction between dissemination of information, including secrets, and the discovery. Don't you agree that the press, the media, have a responsibility to act as the fourth branch of government?
I couldn't quarrel at all with that. I think, you know, we would live in the dark without the media. I guess I'm looking for the points of difference that we have between us. I think Fritz probably agrees with me that the First Amendment is not an absolute bar to prosecution of journalists for publishing mm-hmm. secrets, because if you agree that that could have should have happened in the Chicago Tribune case, mm-hmm. then we're in agreement about a really fundamental issue. The question then becomes, should that ever be applied in the contemporary scene? I made a case back in 2005 that the New York Times should be prosecuted for publishing the terrorist surveillance program. Fritz takes me to task for that in his book. However, what he neglected to note was that I had taken him to task in commentary in 2006, but had by 2010 my position had evolved. And I was a little less eager to do that kind of thing. So yeah. I think getting a little bit more familiar with acknowledging the costs of such a prosecution. But there are, the press plays a vital role in bringing us out of darkness, there is a case for darkness that journalists typically don't acknowledge. And there are genuine secrets that the press is publishing that really do us harm. And I mean, I just let's think of a good example is the James Risen's 2006 book, State of War, which had a chapter in it about a covert CIA operation to feed disinformation to Iran so they would build a faulty nuclear weapon. The government approached James Risen, the New York Times, Jill Abramson, and made the case that this was going to blow a vital operation and possibly cost lives. The Times listened and did not publish this information, hasn't published it to this day. James Risen went ahead and published it in his book and went on to win a Pulitzer for it, for that book. I think that was an act of irresponsibility. I don't hear many journalists agreeing with me.
Would you have prosecuted him for that?
James Risen, well, I think the Espionage Act is probably not intended to prosecute journalists, but there are these special statutes like that protect the identity of intelligence agents and atomic energy information and cryptography. So if he disclosed communications intelligence, and I'm not sure he did, there would be a case. But I don't think, if it's just an Espionage Act prosecution, I don't think there are even the grounds, because the Espionage Act has an intent provision where you have to have reason to believe you're going to harm the U.S. And journalists, whatever his state of mind was, I don't think he had that state of mind.
There certainly are genuine, legitimate secrets that responsible people should not publish. I think, Gabe, where we might have, and we both agree on that, we just would say where you draw the line. I think I emphasize a bit more the extent to which the government is keeping secrets of things because they are illegal or because they would embarrass the government, which means that I don't think you could ever say the president is the person who can make a decision. I think same you probably hard to say journalists always can make the decision. So I think there should be a dialogue. But there are genuine secrets. I think the worst things are when the secret is really designed most to keep the information out of the minds of Americans. And I think an awful lot of the things which the government has tried to keep secret or complain when they were made public were items where it was the government desperately trying to keep it, to use secrecy not to protect America, but to keep information from Americans.
Well, Fritz, you mentioned we're lucky to have Max Frankel in the audience today. In the time of the Pentagon Papers case, the federal judge, the district judge, who heard that case had been on the federal bench, I think, for 4 days. And the question was, when the government, with all its majesty, comes in and says, these are vital national secrets that these scurrilous journalists have just traduced. Max wrote overnight an exceptional brief explaining to the court just how many stories, and we found, I don't know, 20 or 30 or 40 examples from the prior week of public officials, government officials, purposely leaking stories to the press for their own purposes, whether it was to influence their budget or interagency warfare. I think it's fair to say that Max's brief probably did a very good job in helping persuade the judge to rule the way he did. So that's another aspect of the conversation we haven't yet touched on, which is not just government withholding information, but misusing information. Is that something you'd all like to comment on?
Well, I think it's undeniable that the government, as Fritz said, massively overclassifies information, and B, massively leaks information for all sorts of purposes, some of them the ordinary processes of government, some of them for self-interest. And that's why the crime is so ubiquitous that it's so seldom published. I think prosecuted. It's prosecuted in those. I think in all of our history up until the Obama administration, there were only two or three prosecutions of leakers. Now the Obama administration has really gone off in a very, very striking direction and prosecuted, I think we're up to number 9, more than all previous administrations before it. My own interpretation of that is that leaking in Washington got out of hand. A lot of sensitive information was being disseminated. Even the liberals in the Obama administration recognized that this was a problem and made an example of some folks who ended up getting pretty harsh prison terms.
You know, Jack, on the judges you mentioned, Gerfein in New York and Gesell in Washington, they make a point which I speculate about in the book. But if you look at judges who've ruled against the government in secrecy cases, they are almost invariably judges who had experience with the secrecy system themselves. Gesell was on the Pearl Harbor Commission, that the Joint Senate House Commission that looked at Pearl Harbor and got into secrecy and stuff that Truman had tried to keep away from the commission. Gerfein was in a judge advocates program and very much involved. The judge in California who you remember the book Subversives, which was about the infiltration of the FBI into the California education system and trying to subvert the subversive people that J. R. Hoover identified there. That judge who decided the Freedom of Information Act in favor of the writer had been the judge who ruled after the Korematsu case he'd been convicted, or he'd failed to upset the internment, and then his conviction was overturned. She overturned it, and she learned something about the government. Judge Hellerstein here in New York, who's been deciding these issues on photos of the Abu Ghraib and elsewhere, they all had experience with the system. And two other facts that support getting back to your judge's question, in Israel, which has more experience with terrorism than we do, unlike the United States, if someone claims a human rights violation, the Israeli judges don't dismiss the case as a state secret, which the Obama administration has been particularly prone to do, get a whole case dismissed because it's a so-called state secret. And then finally, there's a group as an alternative to FOIA, which is called ISCAP, and it's Interagency Review of Secrecy, State Department, Defense, CIA, National Archives. And they're all experts on secrecy, and they have experience with it. And in 70% of their cases, they decide against the government, whereas in national security cases involving FOIA in the courts, the government almost always wins.
Fritz, along the same line, I'd like to quote from your book when you say that presidents and other high-level executive branch officials know that intelligence activities were smothered by layers of excess secrecy. They know Congress and the courts have played no meaningful checking role, and they know, or should have known, that excessive secrecy, non-existent or weak checks and balances, and fuzzy or open-ended authorizations were invitations for excess and abuse. This remains equally true today. Would you like to spell that out a little?
I mean, it's my quote, so you should get the others to attack it or something.
Well, it's hard to disagree with that. There's massive overclassification in Washington. Numerous government commissions have studied this, thought of ways to address it. All of them have been ignored because the incentives are so strong in the other direction. Now, one of the interesting things that Fritz does in his book is to try and limb some some categories for deciding what should be secret and what shouldn't. And I think, you know, it's very provocative, but ultimately he doesn't succeed either. There's it's a very, very thorny intellectual question about what should be kept secret. I mean, just to give an example, to take an example from the book, you make the case that that Truman's decision to drop the bomb on Hiroshima had not been sufficiently aired, and if it had been, the U.S. Would have not have chosen a civilian target, but would have chosen a military target. But you also say that the secrecy was really appropriate. This was an ultra-sensitive decision. So, you know, you bemoan the secrecy, but you don't really have a remedy for it.
Well, I think I do a little better than that, Gabe, because I do say, leaving aside whether we should have used the bomb, which is outside the scope of this book, certainly today you couldn't do it. It would be a war crime to do it. But I do say it was appropriate to keep secret the date and the place of where to use the bomb. But what I do say about the fact those government people acted in secret and made their decision in May and didn't rethink it between May and August 8th, I think shows why people who make legitimate secrets, who keep legitimate secrets, who are doing something that they know is secret from the world, should continue themselves to think harder because they're not getting the benefit of the press and the public pushing them.
Well, I agree with that, but if you were suggesting that there needed to be more openness about the effects of the bomb,
I think... No, I was not.
Okay,
I was not.
Okay, then we are in agreement.
But I do think you try to address some of the questions about remedies in terms of, you know, hoping that Congress can become more proactive in this area, declassifying secrets on a much greater scale, putting time limits so that they don't stay, if things that are decided to be secret don't remain secret for as long as they do. I mean, I did feel that you attempted to sort of lay out an agenda. Whether it could ever come to pass politically is another issue.
Sarah, I'm really glad you raised that point. So let me turn the discussion to a second question. I think we're all agreed that there are real secrets. How should they be protected? And what to do about the mountains of classified material that have piled up since the Cold War?
Well, I think that there's a kind of conventional wisdom about it that's right, that we should invest more resources into declassification and take all these measures, but I think the experience is not a very happy one. There's no constituency for this, really. The pace at which secrets are created, given the technology, is now outstripping the declassification process. So, and you can't really just automatically declassify everything, because let's say that's 50 years old, because even things that are 50 years old can be awfully important, like the plans for the vital, like, defense installations, the blueprints, or something like that. They bear the secrecy stamp. You make it public, something bad can happen. So you can't craft a rule that encompasses it all. And we are going to live with a lot of secrecy. But fortunately, I mean, all those very frightening numbers about the millions of secrets, you know, a huge percentage of that is just extremely technical information and not the kind of things that the public really has much of an interest in learning.
Then why not declassify them?
Well, it's technical because it would be very valuable to say communist China, to know how we make the F-35 jet.
But one of the things that I found so interesting about the book was the sense of history that pervades, especially the earlier sections, where you realize that, you know, for long periods of time, this country did just fine without this obsession of secrecy, and that there's sort of that default position now that everything is secret unless we say otherwise. Is a culture that we need to really undo, and how refreshing would it be to start with a new administration that perhaps took that as one of its precepts? I don't imagine that that's going to happen anytime soon.
No, but we had an administration that came in, and the Obama administration said, President Obama on his second day in office, I am going to be the most transparent president in the history of this country. Well, guess what? He went in the exact opposite direction, in part because of all the pressures that we all agree are playing on the system.
Yeah, and you, when you're president, you have, you know, the CIA helps you a lot, and you don't want to stab them in a way that, I'm optimistic that we're going to get change for two reasons. One, while the passion is not there to change, there is a bipartisan agreement that there is too much secrecy. Now, you saw Justin Amash, very conservative House Republican, and John Conyers, very liberal House Democrat, joining together to try and overturn the NSA's metadata program when Snowden made his leak. But the other reason is, I think, not yet quite understood, but I think is going to be very powerful, which is that some of the most thoughtful people in the CIA and in the NSA are saying too much secrecy gets in the way of our national security, because they say today the coin of the realm is speed, and having too much secrecy gets in the way of having speed. And also, with all the technological changes, with all of the greater numbers of people who now tend to know about secret things, the shelf life of secrets is getting shorter in any event.
That seems right.
You mentioned Snowden, and of course one can't help but wonder whether you feel that that's advancing the cause of the culture of secrecy, or is actually making people want to take a more aggressive
posture.
Sarah,
let me ask you, if you were in the government, the Attorney General or the President, what would you do about Snowden?
Oh, that's a completely unfair question to ask a journalist. Like, first of all, I can't even imagine being in that position. That's beyond me.
Well, but just as a citizen, what do you
think? As a citizen, I felt that he did the right thing. And there may be people up here who violently disagree with that. But, I'm one of these people who went to see Citizen 4, which was fascinating to me just to watch this man wrestle with what he was doing in I thought, a fairly transparent way. And I thought the way that he did it was very careful, very premeditated. You know, he selected other people to make the judgments about which documents they thought should be released and what would be unsafe. And he didn't want to be in that position. He didn't think he was qualified. So I feel that he took a lot of measures that were, and he put himself at great risk. And it's changed his life forever. I mean, in other words, it wasn't something that he did in a malicious way or in a sort of unthoughtful way. So, I think that this is the kind of, this is the kind of whistleblower that this country's democracy depends upon. And I hate to see him languishing in Russia right now.
And so if he were to come back to this country, what should be done?
He's a citizen.
Well, I disagree.
I was fairly certain that might happen.
If he had stopped with just the domestic surveillance programs that he revealed, he would have a case to be a whistleblower. If he had stopped with just the domestic surveillance programs that he compromised, he would have a case for being a whistleblower. But having gone on and said he was careful, he's basically blinded the United States to terrorist plots, to our understanding of the Chinese. He's given tools to the Chinese government for crushing dissent, because they understand now some of our own tools that we use for tracking terrorists. That's one. So I don't think I think he did a lot more harm, along with the limited good that he may have done. I think that's also debatable. But the other thing, he's not a classic whistleblower. Like, even Daniel Ellsberg, he was ready to face a judge and jury. He wasn't really ready because he hid for a little while, but he did end up, getting put on trial. This man has fled the country, fled justice. And that's not civil disobedience. That's like Rosa Parks, like wearing a mask.
Judge Schwarz, would you like, please,
talk about Snowden a little bit? I mean, I hear some of the points you make, Gabe, and I think the foreign stuff had less justification. I think that's fair.
Snowden strikes me as a truly genuine person. I've known a number of, whether or not he's a whistleblower, I've known a number of whistleblowers, and they're sort of off a little bit. They may be doing a great thing, but they're kind of a little bit off, and he seems absolutely genuine. My own judgment is he did what he did for patriotic reasons. I would distinguish that from General Petraeus, who did what he did for personally selfish reasons, and yet nobody seems to think that General Petraeus should be punished. On the other hand, one can't say that what he gave to his mistress has been published to the world, and that's a different fact. And on your point of fleeing the country, choosing not to come back to be prosecuted, I think the Bradley Manning sentence of 35 years and the mistreatment he had in prison before he was charged give a big deterrent to someone deciding to come back and face justice. So I'd come out more favorable to Snowden. Certainly he helped the country by getting a debate on these domestic subjects. I'd come out more in favor of him because I think his motives were good. I think he had a good impact, and I think the foreign stuff has more dubiety about it, if that's a sentence.
Is it conceivable that this entire conversation is irrelevant in the face of modern technology, big data, capacity of not just foreign governments, but foreign hackers to exploit or expose lots of secrets? Should we be talking more about technology and that arms race than about these?
Well, Jack, I think the technology is one of the reasons the government is going to way cut back on secrecy, because of the reasons I said about the intelligent people in some of the agencies saying it's now getting in the way of our protecting ourselves.
Yeah, I mean, we've entered a new world where you have leakers not leaking one secret or a discrete set of secrets, but entire archives of government secrets. And when Bradley Chelsea Manning did that with those diplomatic cables, you know, we were wondering if that was the taste of things to come, and the government assured us that they were going to take countermeasures to ensure nothing like that would ever happen again. And then it happened again in a much more dramatic fashion. Mm-hmm. So I think, you know, it's very, very difficult to contain the massive amount of secrets that we've generated.
Well, now that we've all come to a wonderfully satisfactory conclusion and consensus, let me turn to the audience and see if you can penetrate some of this. Please wait for microphones. The gentleman in the back?
Just as a clarification, I think at least two of you said that whether or not Snowden is a whistleblower, and if there's any doubt about that, I don't understand the meaning of the word. And is there some implication of saying that he might not be?
Well, I think that anyone in government who takes an oath to protect secrets, to protect the country, and then breaks that oath, cannot simply just declare himself a whistleblower and I'm a good person by virtue of doing that. I mean, let's take a slightly different example. You know, when the government was weighing whether to capture or kill Osama bin Laden, there was a fierce debate about whether that was a good idea, whether, first of all, some our guys could get killed doing it. Second, we were going to violate Pakistani sovereignty, and that was hotly contested. And if somebody in the government, some Snowden type or Ellsberg type, decided, well, you know, there's a debate, and I feel strongly we should not do this, and then went over to James Risen of the Times, and the Times published it, you know, would that be a good thing to have a system like that? Well, that's the system that Snowden essentially created, where you have one guy who is basically trespassing on the workings of a democracy, because a democracy gets to decide what we're doing to protect ourselves against terrorists, not some random civil servant buried in the bowels of the bureaucracy. I don't think he's a whistleblower at all.
Well, I use the phrase whether he's a whistleblower to say I don't think it's relevant to the discussion, but I think he was a whistleblower in the best sense. I mean, he didn't actually do much within the agency because he'd concluded that that would be fruitless and might indeed lead to them, you know, choking him off.
Well, Fritz, on that point, it's a factual point. He makes the point in Citizen Four that other people had tried to do that and were shot down, and he tried twice to do it through channels.
Yeah.
And it was only after he was defeated that he went outside.
Yeah.
Which is the same argument that Daniel Ellsberg made
at
the time.
But keep in mind what he's doing. He's not revealing information about a runaway intelligence agency. He's revealing information about an intelligence agency that's carrying out a program that was instituted by the executive branch, approved by Congress, and approved by 15 Article III judges independently that it was legal. Now, you may disagree with the program now that you know about it. You may think it's a bad idea. I'm not sure it was such a great idea. But the fact is that that was our democracy working, deciding this, not some random guy. And if you allow one random guy to make decisions about this, you're going to have to allow a lot of random guys. And they'll take decisions that you disagree with, and they're going to be every bit as much a whistleblower according to the people who disagree with you. And that won't be democracy anymore, it will be anarchy.
But I think, Gabe, that one can distinguish how one thinks about the material Snowden disclosed, which at the very least raised substantial questions about what should be done in a purported democracy, versus your hypothetical of someone revealing the plan the possibility we were going to try and kill bin Laden. And I think one has to really wrestle with what the facts are and not be overly abstract in addressing them.
Right, I'm just pointing out again that this was a program that all three branches of government had blessed. You can't get better than that. This was not a whistleblower revealing that, you know, somebody was stealing or spying illegally in the NSA. This was democracy subverted. And we disagree. I mean, in the book itself, you rehearse that argument.
Yeah.
We go into it. So it was exciting to read.
Ma'am?
Hello, my name is Melissa Kornick. I am a journalist also. I've met you in the past. But I worked for 60 Minutes, Dateline, 2020 Nightline. I focused on original reporting, so it wasn't something that was tracked before. And I worked under people like Edward R. Murrow's executive producers. I was trained by the best. And Walter Cronkite, in fact, I worked for 5 years. So I have a very particular look at, from spanning all of these shows, at what journalism is in this country, because, you know, I've won lots of awards for the things that I've done, especially with ethics. And I just see journalism as being extremely exclusive. So you look at maybe one exclusive group of people basically running journalism. And so what I see now that things have changed, especially with social media, is that it's much better that it's open. It's much better because you have a lot of crowdsourcing and opinion making that's going on in the general public through social media. So everybody's kind of shifting over there and talking in that way. So my question is to you, do you feel that way as well? I mean, I don't believe you do, but I'm wondering, do you see any value in what's happening right now with it being less exclusive and less controlled by, say, you know, white men or, you know, one race, in fact?
Sarah?
I think it's the most exciting time to be in journalism ever, but I'm biased because I have been in this profession for, I don't know, 35, 40 years now, and now I'm the dean of a public journalism school. So what I see is a tremendous hunger for journalism, for information by a much broader group of people in the audience, and I think the sharing of stories has facilitated a lot of smaller media outlets being able to survive because their audience is there and they don't have to necessarily have the brand name, but people are coming to them through other mechanisms, whether it's Facebook or Twitter or whatever. So
I see a tremendous need for information, a tremendous hunger for information. I think the quality, there's still a long-form commitment, both in writing and in documentaries. We're seeing a resurgence of long-form. But I don't see a very healthy business model for the industry. And I think that disconnect is the problem that we're all trying to figure out how to fix. And there is no silver bullet. And there's a lot of people experimenting, whether it's with membership models or paywalls or, you know, any other number of opportunities to fix that problem. But without a healthy business model supporting this important profession that is so integral to democracy, I think, you know, it's very troubling. But clearly the demand is there. It's just a question of making sure that the foundation stays strong.
Can I just take a quick crack at that? I think the social media revolution is wonderful for journalism, and it's policing an institution that regards itself as the policeman. It's the watchman of the watchmen. And we have two fantastic examples of that. You know, Dan Rather, his career ended when crowdsourcing journalists descended upon his bogus reports about Bush's service in the National Guard. And now more recently, Brian Williams has also succumbed.
So,
well, I think it's good that the monopoly, to the extent there is a monopoly, is cracking.
Jack McKenzie. Wait, Mike.
When you say that the security programs are democratically blessed, I think you're a bit romantic about that. I think that, I mean, when you, Congress doesn't know squat about this stuff. Things go past them in a 30-second briefing, and if you don't ask the right questions of the CIA, you must know this, you don't get any answer, or else you get a lie. If you ask the right question, you get a lie. If you ask the wrong question, you get no answer. So this is not a democratic thing.
Congress makes its own rules, and as you know, and their rules were that the four ranking members of Congress, and two from the House, two from the Senate, would be briefed about the most sensitive issues and then had the responsibility to inform others. And in the Section 215 program, which is what's at issue here, there was a classified briefing and a classified document describing the program that was available in the classified reading room of Congress. I mean, there are things that Congress, that are done by our government in secret, that have to be done in secret. And Congress, if it's not informing itself, is in a position to inform itself. I agree with you that it doesn't work as it should. There could be much more oversight. But that is how our broken, flawed democracy works.
Congress, though, in those briefings of the Gang of Four and the Gang of Eight, point one, I mean, yes, there's a little bit of information, but they have to go only one at a time. They can't take notes. They can't bring staff people. They can't discuss it with their colleagues. And then I think there's another more subtle point that the people in those positions who are given the exclusive briefings, I think ultimately it becomes part of the seduction of secrecy that they begin saying, I'm a pretty important person. I get these exclusive briefings and I don't want to rock the boat.
You know, I think any democracy that a democracy that has great power, that exercises a role in the world, has to wrestle with this problem of having an intelligence agency that operates in secret. And it's a very tough problem. As you know, your career was, you know, intimately involved in regulating the secrets of our government. And there is no perfect way. Those things are our intention, and they're never going to work well. But that's how they are. I mean, that doesn't give a license to random people to derail the workings of a democracy. That's my point. I agree that, you know, there's room for great improvement in the operations of our democracy.
Sir.
I apologize in advance, but Hillary Clinton's unilateral decision to delete emails from her time in office, your comments on that? That is a enforced secrecy.
I could make one, and the others will have one too. First, let's give a little history. When the Presidential Records Act was passed in 76 or 78, and for the first time said the government, the people of the United States, own the documents of high-ranking officials, presidents, and secretaries of departments, the Reagan administration, the George H.W. Bush administration, and the Clinton administration all argued that somehow emails weren't documents, and they weren't covered by the act. Now, the courts knocked that down, but interestingly, there's been some culture about emails are different. And then I think you put your finger on the most interesting part of this study, of this issue, which is not that she had a machine that did both her private and her public, but the destruction of the things that her lawyers had not decided were governmental communications. And Doris Kearns Goodwin has it right on target, where she says, well, those are the documents where people talk about how they felt about something, or how they thought about how someone else was performing. And they're not, you know, part of their official actions, but those are the documents that tell the ultimate truth about motivations and so forth for history. And I think the destruction of, let's assume her lawyers were 100% right and they turned over everything that should have been officially a government document, still destroying all the other things was a big disservice to history.
I agree with that, and I also think that her claim that this private server contained no classified information at any point is not credible. She's the Secretary of State. She's conducting all of her correspondence through an unclassified private government server, easily accessible or readily accessible to hackers. There are other government officials, and I'm blanking on the name of the CIA director who did a similar thing and put
Deutsch,
who put classified information on his personal computer and was facing criminal charges for that until Clinton pardoned him on his last day in office. So, you know, I don't know if the Holder Justice Department or the Loretta Lynch Justice Department is going to investigate this, but there is a case.
I agree. I think it's incredibly disappointing what happened, and I think that the idea that her lawyers are the ones who decide what should be turned over, you know, that's like ridiculous. Like, you know, those are the people that should not be the ones who are choosing. That's not the definition of an open democracy. But the other thing that I always that I remain puzzled by is the claim that I think Obama made that he had no idea this was going on. I mean, how do you keep getting emails from, you know, your secretary from, you know, Clinton's email account and not notice that everyone else is using, you know, U.S. government email and that one's coming? I find that so implausible that no one noticed in all this time. So it's, you know, the whole thing is very troubling.
There's a development some of us recently became aware of when the former general counsel of the New York Times has just been appointed to something called the Public Information Classification Board, whose mission is to slow down classifications and also to see about declassification. What do we know about that board, and is it just window dressing?
It's quite new. I don't know. They asked me to come speak, and then I wasn't able to. My wife is getting an incredible environmental award, so I had to turn them down and go to my wife's award. So that's where my priorities are.
From my limited knowledge, you know, it's doing worthy things that are never going to happen.
At the rate of 100 million a day. If there are no more questions, sir.
I don't know enough about the statute involved, but if Snowden came back to the United States and was prosecuted, could he have been prosecuted in secret as opposed to having a public trial?
No. Could Snowden have been prosecuted in secret as opposed to a public trial?
Let me invite you all to join us in the Four Freedoms Room on the first floor
for a cocktail and an autograph of the famous author, Fritz Schwarz.